Praise the Lord. Are you there? I said, praise the Lord. Rise up as we pray together. Almighty God, we do thank you for this blessed day. Thank you for the day you've given us in the week that we gather together, celebrate your name, and worship who you are, and then receive of your hand so that we can live the life that pleases you all the time. We're asking, Lord, today as we come to hear your word, as we worship you, we pray that everything we do, from our motive to our hearts, to our attitude, to hearing the word, and to responding to the word, will be a blessing to us and to people around us in Jesus' name. I pray, Lord, that your mighty blessings will pour down upon everyone, and the grace to live, and the grace to walk in this narrow path that leads to heaven, you grant to every one of us in Jesus' name. Make this day a great day for everyone. Thank you, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you. God bless you. You can sit down. We're looking at Genesis chapter 5. I'm reading to you from verse 22. Genesis chapter 5. And we're looking at verse 22. And we're reading all the way to verse 24. In Genesis chapter 5, here is what it says. And Enoch walked with God. And Enoch walked with God. What a statement that is. At the time in which Enoch lived, corruption was at its deepest, and compromise was at its widest. At the time that Enoch lived, sin was at its highest, and it pervaded everywhere, permeated everything, and affected and influenced everything and everyone. And yet it says that Enoch walked with God. After he begat Methuselah 300 years, and he begat sons and daughters. He was not a teenager. He was not a single man. He was a married man. Some people tell us today that once you are married, all those pressures in marriage, all those problems in marriage will not even allow you to walk with God, will not allow you to remember who God is and what God demands. But this man had a wife. We're not told that the wife was very spiritual or very religious or very committed, but all the same, it says Enoch walked with God. There are people that tell us that the challenge of their lives is because, you know, they have children. And if they didn't have children, and they didn't have to combat with all the things that, you know, all these teenagers will bring up on the question they will be asking, if they didn't have all that, they could live a righteous life, a holy life, a sanctified life. And Enoch walked with God after he begat Methuselah 300 years, and he begat sons and daughters. Being a married man doesn't hinder our walking with God. Having children does not hinder our walking with God. Look at verse 23. And all the days of Enoch were 365 years. 365 years. And then it says again, and Enoch walked with God. He doesn't want you to lose the trend of what we're talking about. He walked with God. He had a wife, he had children, and then he lived all these days, and then he begat the oldest man that ever lived in the world, and he comes back again to say, and Enoch walked with God. And then it says, and he was not, and he was not. He walked with God until he just went to glory. Because this walking with God is going to lead somewhere. When you are walking and walking and walking, and you are moving somewhere and you are getting somewhere, eventually God said the world was not worthy to contain this man. This man is too good for the earth. This man is too pure for this corrupt world. And even though nobody was promised rapture, at that time, all that God promised to Adam and Eve after the sin is that dust thou art, and to dust thou shalt return. But in the case of Enoch, God went beyond more than 4,000 years and more than 6,000 years. He said, what I'm still going to do for the church in the years to come, in the centuries to come, in the millennia to come, what I want to do for the church this man is too good, I'm going to do it for him now. And Enoch walked with God, and it was not, because it says in verse 24, for God took him. We've seen the beginning of a life of walking with God. We call that grace. The beginning of walking with God, we call that redemption. When you turn away from your sin, and this man did that at the age of 65. He wasn't born a saint. Nobody is born a saint. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But then he tells us that even though the wages of sin is death, the gift of God and the gift of grace is eternal life. And this man got redemption. And he got the grace of God. And at that age, he began to walk with God. We see the beginning. What's the beginning? It is the grace of redemption. The grace of redemption. That's where we start. And then you find at the end, that's the glory of rapture. The glory of the rapture. He started with grace. He ended with glory. He began with redemption. And then you have the rapture. But then we need to know what was in between. Because being born again is the starting point. And then going to glory is the final point. What happened to this man? In between the grace of redemption and the glory of rapture, what happened was the government of Israel. The government of Israel. You see what? What this man did is that he said, I've given my life to the Lord. I am redeemed. I am saved. I am forgiven. My sins are taken away. I began with the grace of redemption. I'm going to allow him to reign in my life. The government of Israel. Reign, Master Jesus. Reign, Master Jesus, over my heart, over my life, over my action, over my decisions. The reign of his government, or the government of Israel. That's what happened all those 300 years. The Lord guided him, and the Lord gifted him, and the Lord supported him, and the Lord helped him. And he went on and on and on in the things of the Lord. And the man walked with God. And eventually, as he walked with God, he went on to glory. I'm talking to you today on the fundamental blessings while walking with God to glory. Fundamental blessings while walking with God to glory. We're walking to glory. We're moving on to glory. And every day of those years we're walking with the Lord, blessings are going to reach your life in Jesus' name. You just see, you see that if you start with grace and you're going to end with glory, his government will be upon your life. His guidance will be upon your life. Righteousness will characterize your life. In between the time of redemption and the time of the rapture. I'm looking at Hebrews chapter 11 and I'm looking at verse 5. Hebrews chapter 11 and we're looking at verse 5. It says in verse 5, by faith Enoch was translated that he should not see death. Hold on for a moment. Everyone that is born into this world, in fact, when Adam had sinned and Eve had sinned, and then God came down and said, Adam, where art thou? And he said, I heard your voice in the garden and I was afraid. Why were you afraid? Have you eaten of the fruit of the tree of which I told you not to eat? He said, it's not my fault, God. It's the woman that you gave me that gave me the fruit. And then he says, Eve, what have you done? And Eve also gave excuse. It's not my fault. It's Satan. It's the serpent that beguiled me. And then a curse came upon Satan, upon the serpent. A curse came upon the woman, and a curse came upon the man. And then the general thing is appointed unto man once to die. That's not because of what you have done. Because you listen to your wife, Adam, you didn't listen to me. And because you listen to the serpent, Eve, and you didn't listen to me, dost thou art, and to dust you will return. And since that time, everybody died. Coming from Adam to Eve and to Cain and to Abel and to everybody, they were dying. But then it came to the time of this man. And then God had to suspend just for this man what he pronounced upon everybody. Holiness pays. Righteousness pays. His sanctified life pays. Purity pays. And when you are walking with God, walking consistently with God, it pays. It says, by faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death. And he was not found because God had translated him. God will translate you. But before his translation, before the rapture, he had this testimony that he pleased God. He had this testimony that he pleased God. As I told you already, he was working to please the Lord. And he had the government of the Almighty God to control his life and to direct his life and to lead him in every way that he lived. And that's why, and then God gave him fundamental blessings. When you come to know the Lord, you are born again, you are a child of God. He supports you, he strengthens you, and he sustains you. And all the way that you are walking, as you are moving on, he guides you and he controls your life, and he helps you to be the man, the woman you ought to be. There are fundamental blessings that he grants unto you. And we're going to talk about the fundamental blessings while walking with God to glory. There are three things we're going to look at in this message. Number one, exceptional rapture for walking consistently with God. Exceptional rapture. It never happened to any other person in that age or at that time. It was exceptional. It was exclusive. It was just for him because of he singled himself out. He said, I know the way the world is moving. I know the direction the world is going. But I make up my mind, I'm going to be different. As was deciding to be different here on earth, God said, Enoch, I'm going to make you different. What everybody else goes through, you will not go through. You know, your life, when you decide to walk with God and you make yourself exceptional, uncompromising, and you will not just flow with the trend or the tide or the ocean of corruption around you. You make God special in your life, God will make you special. What happens to them will not happen to you. The destruction that comes on them will not come upon you. And the devastation, desolation that comes upon the people of the world will not come upon you in Jesus' name. Exceptional rapture for walking consistently with God. Point number two, excellent returns. When we talk about returns, we're talking about gain. Excellent returns. We're talking about returns. We're talking about profit. Excellent returns. We're talking about you're counting your blessings. It's like the word, that's the word accountants use. They say the returns, the returns. You're at the market and then you say, here is what I put in. Here is what came back. That's the returns. Excellent returns while walking courageously with God. You see, when everybody is sliding down, for you to stand and to walk in righteousness, you have to be courageous. When everybody is putting pressure on you and they say, this is the way the world is going. If you're going to be any different, you need courage. And you want to tell that this man, you see Enoch, he had courage because he faced all those people and he said, God is coming with 10,000 of his saints, and is going to bring judgment upon all the people that are living ungodly. Nobody said that at his time. Even in Noah, Noah came after him, but this man was alone by himself, and the man was courageous. You're alone in your family and you want to take your stand like Enoch. Courage is necessary. You're in your place of work and you say, I know what they're doing. I know how they change all those retreats, but I'm not going to change any receipt. I'm going to stand like this. You need courage. That courage you have today. I said that courage you have today. It's like in every profession, there is a mark of corruption. No matter where you work, and no matter what you have studied, and no matter what community you live in, no matter what company you're working in, there is corruption. But the man that says, I will not join them. I will not be like them. I will live a sanctified life, a holy life, a responsible life, a righteous life. That man will manifest courage. Excellent returns while walking courageously with God. Point number three, eternal rewards. That's what God is going to give you. I said that's what God is going to give you. Eternal rewards for walking conscientiously with God. Conscientiously with God. You know, in the world in which we're living, there's no conscience. The people have sold their conscience to evil. The love of money has taken their conscience away. And they love money so much that conscience is silenced. But this man had a pure conscience. This man had a purged conscience. And this man had a conscience that said, okay, my heart will not allow that. My conscience will not allow that. Some people will say they are Christians. They don't have any conscience. They have their conscience seared with hot iron. They do what they do. They know the thing is evil. They know the thing is corrupt. They know that the thing is defiling. But their conscience is not there anymore. Salvation does not affect their conscience. Bible reading does not affect their conscience. And then preaching, all that we're hearing, does not affect their conscience. But this man Enoch, he had a conscience. He had a conscience. And then he walked conscientiously with God. And there are eternal rewards for those people. Number one is walking consistently. Number two is walking courageously. Number three is walking conscientiously. Let's come to number one. It is the exceptional rapture for walking consistently with God. Let's read that verse again. It's Hebrews chapter 11. And I'm reading here from verse 5. It says, by faith Enoch was translated that he should not see death, and he was not found because God had translated him. But for before his translation, he had this testimony: heaven will testify about you, God will testify about you, the angels will testify about you. Before his translation, before the rapture, all the people that are going to take part in the coming rapture, belonging to the church, they're going to have a testimony that is not just a testimony on earth. It's not just your own testimony. It's the testimony of God concerning you, and the testimony of the angels concerning you, and the testimony of heaven concerning you. He had this testimony that he pleased God. If we're going to really please God, we need to walk with God. Walk with God. And you're looking at Psalm 86. What does it mean when it said, he walked consistently with God? That means he walked constantly with God. That means every day. That means up and down on the mountain. He was still walking with God. In the valley, he was walking with God. In the day, at the sun shining, he was walking with God. In darkness, he was walking with God. When other people were watching him, and they say, this is a difficult situation. This is a tempting situation. It's going to bend a little. The man was walking with God. In adversity, he was walking with God. In prosperity, he was walking with God. When people understood him, he was walking with God. When people misunderstood him, he was walking with God. A consistent man, and he was consistently walking with God. There were times of sorrow. When you have children, and those children are growing up, there are things you'll do that will be like almost a dagger in your heart. And at those times of sorrow, he was walking with God. And when you have a wife that doesn't have all your conviction, and is not really following you step after step, because the wife was not raptured, the wife was still here after he was gone. But all the same, at the time of understanding, at the time of misunderstanding, at the time of adversity, and at the time of sorrow, and at the time of joy, joy did not make the man to forget, I have a destination. I have the place I'm going. You see, when some people are happy, they forget themselves. And they do not walk with God anymore. We're talking about a man. In all situations of life, he walked with God. He walked with God. I'm talking about you today. You will walk with God. In all situations in your life, whatever comes, whatever goes, whatever is given to you, whatever is taken away from you, you will walk consistently with the Lord. Look at this in Psalm 86. Psalm 86, I'm looking at it in verse 11. Psalm 86, and we're reading from verse 11. It says, teach me thy way, O Lord, I will walk in thy truth. I will walk in the truth. Unite my heart to fear thy name. You see, that's the reason we learn about this Enoch. He said, I want to walk in the truth. Can two walk together except they be agreed? You know that the truth is of God, and God is true and truthful all the time. If the man did not agree with the truth coming from heaven, if he did not agree with the doctrine coming from heaven, if he did not agree with the teaching coming from heaven, he couldn't walk with God. He said, look at what the psalmist, teach me thy way. Teach me thy way. Oh Lord, I will walk. Whatever others do, I will walk. Somebody is making up his mind today. I said somebody is making up her mind today. I will walk in thy truth, because error will knock at your door. False doctrine will knock at your door. And false misinterpretation will knock at your door. You say, I have made up my mind. I will walk in thy truth. Look at Psalm 119. And I'm reading here from verse 1. Walking consistently with the Lord. In Psalm 119, I'm reading from verse 1. Blessed are the undefiled in the way. Blessed are the undefiled in the way. In this way that leads to heaven. In the pilgrimage of the believer, in the walk of the child of God, there are many things that will come that will try to defile you. The ceremonies of the world will try to come and defile you. Friends in the world will try to come and defile you. Tradition in the world will come to try and they'll try to defile you. And the cultures of the world will come and they want to defile you. And the cultures and the tradition of our families, extended family, they'll try to come and defile us. They don't understand holiness. They don't understand sanctification. They don't understand the rapture. They don't understand what it means to walk consistently with the Lord. In your place of work, there are practices that will come and they'll try to defy you. But if you're like Enoch, and thank God you are. I said, thank God you are. You make up your mind, blessed are the undefiled in the way, who walk in the law of the Lord. Who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are they that keep his testimony, that seek him with the whole heart. They also do no iniquity. These are people like Enoch. They do no iniquity. Whether people are there or not, they are men and women of conscience. Whether people are there or not, they're women and men of conviction. Whether people are there or not, they're people that say, I have decided to follow the Lord. I have decided to walk with the Lord. No turning back. No turning back. Friends may oppose me. There's no turning back. The world may oppose me. There's no turning back. These are the people. They also do no iniquity. They walk in his ways. You're walking the way of the Lord in Jesus' name. Look at verse 30 there. Look at verse 30 there. There's a personal choice. It says in verse 30, I have chosen the way of truth. I have chosen. Others may not choose it. That's their responsibility. I personally, whatever others do, I'm going to walk in this way until the end of my life. And it says, I have chosen the way of truth. Thy judgments have I hid before me. Have I kept laid before me. Look at verse 37 there. Here, this is what Enoch did. This is how you walked with God. This is how that man was consistent. Look at verse 37. Turn away mine eyes from beholding vanity and quicken me in thy way. As it was, walking, sometimes you're walking on the road, even in the natural, and then all these, there are billboards that they put there, and all these, roadside television they put there, and then you see something, it will almost slow you down, and then it will turn your face towards that thing. Then you remember, I'm on my way to glory. I'm on my way to heaven. Turn my eyes from beholding vanity. Sometimes you're going on the road and these people, they don't even block the road. The cars are going and the cars are moving, and then there is disco going along on the side of the road. It may be one man, one woman, and then they're doing something that you say, I don't want to see that. I can't see that because I'm on my way to glory. And that's why the man was turn away my eyes from beholding vanity. And you will see many things around, but if you're going to walk with God, and nothing will derail you. I'm talking to somebody there. I said, nothing will derail you. that heaven, you will get there. Because you made a personal choice. And in that personal choice, you are telling the Lord, turn away mine eyes from beholding vanity. Look at verse 60 there. In verse 60, it says, I made haste and delayed not to keep thy commandments. And that's what happened to Enoch. He said, I made haste. I always remember the commandment of the Lord. I see what people do. I say, Lord, remind me of your commandment that goes against that. I see where people go. I said, Lord, remind me of your commandment that contradicts that. I see the direction people are living. And I say, Lord, remind me what commandment it is. And he says, I made haste to keep the commandments of the Lord. I'm always different from the people of the world. I'm always different from the people that do not have a destiny. They do not know they have a destination. They do not know where they're going, and they're not thinking of where they're going. I make up my mind. I'm not going to be part of them. Look at verse 5. Look at verse 113. Psalm 119, verse 113. It says, I hate vain thoughts, but thy law do I love. That's Enoch. That's what happened to him. That's the reason he went on and on walking in the way of the Lord. He said, I hate vain thoughts. Not just the action, not just the practice, even the thought of it, I hate it. You know, some people, they will say, you know, I didn't really go into the action. Tell me about that. I don't know about, I didn't go into the action. The man said, I hate even the thought of adultery, even the thought, I hate it. I hate the thought of fornication, even the thought of it, I hate it. I hate the thought of corruption. It's not just the action itself. There is a burning hatred in the heart of a righteous man, a man that is going to heaven, a man that wants to get to heaven, a woman that wants to make it at last. It says, I hate every vain thought, and then thy law do I love. Look at 120, verse 128. It says in verse 128, it says, therefore I esteem all thy precepts concerning all things to be right, and I hate every false way. You know what he's saying? He said, everything in the word of God, I'm not picking and choosing. You know, there are people, they pick and choose. If they hear about healing, they say, yes, Lord, that's for me. If they hear about prosperity, yes, Lord, that's for me. If they hear about restitution, I don't know about that one. If they hear about holiness, I don't know about that one. If they hear about hellfire, I don't know about that one. Tell me about prosperity. This man said, I'm not picking and choosing. I take all the word of God. I accept all the word of God. And whatever it is coming out of the word of God, that's what I love. That's why it says, therefore, because I've made up my mind to walk consistently with God, therefore, I esteem all thy precepts concerning all things to be right. And I hate every false way. Verse 136. In verse 136, rivers of waters run down mine eyes. Rivers of waters run down mine eyes because they keep not thy law. You see, when other people sinning makes you sad, makes you sorrowful, makes you cry, makes you weep, makes you shed tears profusely, rivers of waters run down mine eyes because they keep not thy commandment. You cannot be sorrowful and join them. You cannot be unhappy and join them. You cannot be mourning as if somebody has died and join them. You cannot be weeping profusely and still join them. And they even see you, and they will even pity you, and they will say, for his sake, let us stop this. The man is killing himself with sorrow because he sees us drinking, because he sees us blaspheming the name of the Lord, because he sees us following after things that are not right, and because he sees that we're not saved, we're not born again, and because he sees that we don't have scriptural conviction, the man has broken down. The man is not even able to talk now. He's not able to talk to us. He's just crying and crying. crying, the people will know. They will know that this is an Enoch. He cannot bear that which is evil. He cannot see that which is evil and still go along with them. That's why it says in that verse 136, rivers of waters run down mine eyes, because they keep not thy law. But you know, if you backslide, it's because you're not crying for the backsliders. If you backslide, it's because you're not paying, your heart is not paying for those who are doing evil. If you're careless and compromising, it is because it doesn't pain you in your heart that this is what Jesus died for, and this is what made Jesus to have that agonizing cup of the wrath of God. That's what he died for. And they're doing that, and they're blaspheming the Lord, and yet it doesn't concern you. It doesn't make you cry and weep and be sorrowful and mourn. That's why people backslide. But if you're always sorrowful when you see them doing evil, you're always sorrowful when you see them that you're going in the wrong direction, you will not backslide. And I pray you will not backslide. I'm talking to somebody. I said you will not backslide. You see, Enoch walked with God, and it was consistent. It was consistent. You look at Micah chapter 6. I'm reading from verse 8. Micah chapter 6. And here we're reading from verse 8. You will see what the Lord is saying. When it says Enoch walked with God, this is what it means. It's not talking about something physical. It's not talking about something natural. It's talking about the walk of the righteous. It's talking about the walk of the person that is upright. It's talking about the walk of the person that is actually following after the way of the Lord and the will of the Lord and the revelation of the Lord. It tells us in Micah chapter 6, and we're reading from verse 8, it says, but he has shown thee, O man, what is good and what does the Lord require of thee. And that's what Enoch knew. He knew what the Lord required. He knew what the Lord demanded. And then it says, but to do justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with thy God. And to walk humbly with thy God. And what does that mean? It says, I'm not proud to say I'm the one setting the rule. I'm the one calling the shots. God is the one setting the rule. He is my maker. He is my redeemer. And he is my creator. He is high, higher than the heavens. What am I? Dust of the ground, dust and ashes. I cannot dictate to God. Here is what God has said. And I cannot question God. And I cannot say, God, why did you put that in your word? Why did you go against that? That's a small thing. That's an insignificant thing. He says, who am I? This is what he has called me to. That whatever he has said in his word, I'll be humble enough to say, Lord, I may not even understand. Why do I need to understand? If I understand everything God demands, then I am God. I'm like God. I'm as wise as God. If I understand everything he commands, if I understand why he said this, why he didn't say that, and why he said do this and don't do that, if I understand everything, I'll be like God. But if I am humble and I say I cannot be as wise as God, I may not understand why he demands what he demands, but my own duty, my responsibility is to walk humbly with my God. That's actually what made God happy about Enoch. And they were told that it was not because God took him. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And I'm reading here from verse 7 and verse 8. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We're looking at it from verse 7. It says in verse 7, it says, for we walk by faith and not by sight. What's going to be the result of that? If you're walking by faith and not by sight, you're walking by faith and not by feeling. You're not walking by faith and not walking by the natural. You're walking by faith and you're not walking by what people around you do. It says, but we walk by faith and not by sight. We are confident. Immediately it says we're walking by faith. It says we're confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present of the Lord. It's talking about going to glory. It says, if we walk by faith in verse 7, and we're walking consistently by faith in verse 7, and we're walking conscientiously by faith in verse 7, it says the result is that we'll be translated, we'll be taken out of this world, and then we'll be absent from the body and present with the Lord. We're looking at Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 17. Philippians chapter 3, and we're looking at verse 17. It says in Philippians chapter 3, And in verse 17, it says, brethren, be ye followers together of me, and mark them which walk so as ye have us for an example. It says, mark them, mark them. And then he puts the bracket, it says, you will see this, and this will make you cry. You'll see this, and this will make you weep. You'll see this, and rivers of waters will flow down from your face or from your eyes. It says, for many walk of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ. They say they are Christians, they are enemies of the cross of Christ. They say they are believers, they are enemies of the cross of Christ. They say they are believers, they put Christ to shame. Their lives, they put Christ to shame. And their practices put Christ to shame. They say they are believers, they say they are saved, they say they are born again. But the way they live, Paul the apostle said, I'm weeping for them, I'm weeping on their behalf, because they are the enemies of the cross whose end is destruction. They say they are saved, their end is destruction, whose God is their belly. They say they are saved, and whose glory is in their shame. They say they are saved, who mind earthly things. Now, leave that bracket. Come, let me come back to verse 17, and we're going to meet the parentheses. We're going to meet the brackets. It says in verse 17, brethren, be ye followers together of me, and mark them which walk so as ye have us for an example. Now in verse 20, for our conversation is in heaven, our manner of life is in heaven, our concern is in heaven, our commitment is in heaven, our concentration is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body. He'll change our weak body. He'll change our sickly body. He'll change our fleshly body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself. That's talking about the rapture. And you know what he's saying? He says, we're walking with God, as you have us, for example, and we're walking in the perfect way, we're walking in the good way, we're walking in righteousness step by step, and following after the Lord, and following after the example of the apostles that are following him closely. And then after that, he says, our concern is heaven. Our conversation is in heaven. Our concentration is heaven. Christ will come, and those of us who are walking consistently with him, he'll change our vile body. We'll be conformed and fashioned as unto his glorious body. And then he'll take us away. You'll be part of that in Jesus' name. Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. I read from verse 1. It says, furthermore, then we beseech you, brethren, and exhort you by the Lord Jesus, as ye have received of us, how ye ought to, what's the next word there? Ought to walk and to please God. Ought to walk and to please God. So ye would abound more and more. Ye would abound more and more. Why? For what reason? What's going to happen at the end of walking with God and pleasing God consistently? Look at verse 15 there. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent, precede, or hinder them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds. And then he says, to meet the Lord in the air. So shall we ever be with the Lord. He talks about walking with the Lord and walking to please the Lord in verse 1. And then he goes on, talks about sanctification in verse 3. Talks about holiness in verse 7. And then he comes to the rapture. You see that? And that's what it takes. You're walking consistently with the Lord. And then there's going to be that exceptional rapture. What does that mean? Exceptional rapture. That means you're in your place of work, and if you're the only believer there, I don't mean only church goers, there are many church goers there. You're the only believer there that is working consistently with God. The trumpet shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise. And then you alone, exceptional rapture, he will take you away. I said it will take you away. You might be the only one, I'm sorry, in your family that, you know, you are redeemed, you are saved, you are righteous, you are pure, you are godly, you are consistently walking with the Lord. And then all the members of your family, they say that, hey, brother is taking this thing too far. Brother is, putting all this on his head. God loves everybody, for God so loved the world that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That's so, and we've done that, and we all believe in the Lord, but you are walking with God and you are standing for God. It may be your extended family, you might even be with them. All of a sudden the trumpet shall sound, and then the dead in Christ shall rise. Then it says, we which are alive will be caught together away from them all of a sudden. Where is brother? Where is so and so? We cannot see him. Exceptional rapture. And thank God it will happen to me. I said, thank God it will happen to you. It will happen to you in Jesus' name. We're coming now to point number two. Excellent returns while walking courageously with God. Excellent returns while walking courageously with God. Now, if a man's courage, you're going to walk in this adulterous generation and you're going to single yourself out. That demands courage. You're walking in this compromising situation in this world, and you're going to walk consistently and uprightly before the Lord. It demands courage. You're walking among churchgoers and the people that they say we're Pentecostals, we're evangelicals, we're, you know, Orthodox churches, which we go to church and we read the creed and read the litany, and we even follow the Lent, and we're fasting all this time. And yet, you know, fasting in the Lent does not hinder adultery and fornication, does not hinder drunkenness and evil, does not hinder immorality, does not hinder polygamy, it does not hinder, you know, having us man at home and going after other men. But you don't want to be any part of them. You want to take your stand and you want to walk courageously. It's going to take courage. Look at Genesis. I'm reading from chapter 17. Genesis chapter 17, I'm reading here from verse 1. Now you know how corrupt and how evil the time and the people of Abraham, how they were. In fact, God had to call him out and say, Abraham, come out. And he had to come out in chapter 17. And when Abraham was 90 years old and 9, the Lord appeared to Abraham and said unto him, I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be thou perfect. Walk before me and be thou perfect. Look at verse 2. And I will make my covenant between me and thee. If you do that, here is going to be the returns. The returns. Here is going to be the result. Here is going to be the remuneration. Here is going to be the recompense. What I'm going to give you, it says, and I will make my covenant between me and thee, and will multiply thee exceedingly. But it says, I'm waiting for you to walk courageously with me, and to walk perfectly with me. And when you do that, I'll give you the result. I'll give you the returns. Look at verse 6. And I will make thee exceeding fruitful. That's the return. That's the result. If you will walk consistently with the Lord and courageously with the Lord, and it says, and I will make nations of thee, and kings shall come out of thee. And then Abraham knew that. He said, I have the returns. I'm going to, everything you do, then God will be involved with it. Look at chapter 24. Chapter 24, I'm reading from verse 14. Genesis. Chapter 24, verse 20, verse 40, the returns. And he said unto me, the Lord before whom I walk will send his angels before thee and prosper thy way. He was sending as the chief servant of his house to go and take a wife for Isaac. And then the servant said, what if the lady will not come with me? He said, don't worry about that. He said, the Lord before whom I walk. You see, your confidence that if you're walking before the Lord consistently, if you're walking before the Lord with conviction, if you're walking with the Lord with righteousness, if you're walking with the Lord in righteousness and in holiness, it says, I'm sure of this, the Lord before whom I walk, he will send his angel before thee, and then he will prosper thy way. Look at Leviticus chapter 26. The returns while you're walking with the Lord courageously, courageously. In Leviticus chapter 26, you know, when you are not courageous, you are looser. When you are not walking with the Lord courageously, you will lose the smile of heaven. You will lose the returns from heaven. You will lose all the provision of heaven. And then what are you going to get? The people you are compromising with, and that makes you not to have any backbone, that makes you to be like a coward, that makes you to be a person that cannot be depended upon, even those people will not respect you. You see, we know his conviction, we know her conviction, but because we are here, he cannot carry out his conviction. Because we are here, she cannot stand by conviction. They will not respect you, and heaven will not respect you. Heaven will not give you any special place or any special blessing. But when you are walking with God consistently, and you're walking with God constantly, and you're walking with God courageously, heaven will pour blessings upon your life. Somebody saying amen over there. Look at Leviticus chapter 26. I'm reading from verse 3. It says, if you walk in my statutes and keep my commandments and do them, then I will give you rain in due season, and the land shall yield her increase, and the trees of the field shall yield their fruit, and your threshing shall reach unto vintage, and the vintage shall reach unto the sowing time, and ye shall eat, and ye shall eat, and ye shall eat your bread to the full, and dwell in your land safely. It says, these are the returns if you're walking with the Lord. You're walking constantly, consistently, courageously with the Lord. These are the returns. Look at verse 6. And I will give peace in the land, and ye shall lie down, and none shall make you afraid. And I will rid evil beasts out of the land, neither shall the sword go through your land. And ye shall chase your enemies, and they shall fall before you by the sword. Five of you shall chase 100, and 100 of you shall put 10,000 to flight. Your enemies shall fall before you by the sword. It says, if you're walking with the Lord, here are the excellent returns. What the Lord will do with you, he'll go before you, he'll go behind you. Underneath you will be the everlasting arms. He'll be on your side, and the Lord will protect you and preserve you all the days of your life. For I will have respect unto you, verse 9, and make you fruitful, and make you fruitful. You are no more barren. And multiply you and establish my covenant with you. Look at verse 10. And ye shall eat old store and bring forth the old because of the new. In verse 11, I will set my tabernacle among you, and my soul shall not abhor you. Look at verse 12. And I will walk among you and will be your God, and ye shall be my people. I am the Lord your God. You see what the Lord is saying? He says, walk with me and then I'll recompense you. Walk with me and then I will bless you. What if you go the opposite direction? What if you say, that is too much for me? And instead of walking with God, you're walking contrary to God. Look at verse 21. Look at verse 21. And if ye walk contrary unto me because of the fear of man, if ye walk contrary unto me because of the pressure of the people in your place of work, if ye walk contrary unto me because of society that has gone down the drain and they have gone the way of corruption, if ye walk contrary to me because the Bible is strange, holiness is strange to the people around you, all they know is the way of the world and they're putting the pressure on you, if ye walk contrary to me and will not hearken unto me, I will bring seven times more plagues upon you according to your sins, because you are walking contrary. Look at verse 23. In verse 23, and if ye will not be reformed by me, by these things, and will walk contrary unto me, then in verse 24, I will also walk contrary unto you, and will punish you yet 7 times for your sins. You see what the Lord is saying? He says, if you walk with me, and you are walking consistently, courageously, constantly with me, here are the blessings I will give you. But if you become a coward and you fear the people of the world more than you fear me, it says, I will walk contrary to you. I'll turn all the blessing to you. Because look at verse 27. And if ye will not for all this hearken to me, but walk contrary unto me, then I will walk contrary unto you also in fury, and I, even I, will chastise you 7 times for your sins. It's telling us that if we do not walk in line with the Lord, it's going to be terrible. But I know that this year is going to be wonderful. I said this year for you there, my brother, my sister, is going to be wonderful. Because you're making up your mind that you're going to walk consistently, courageously, constantly with the Lord. And the Lord will reward your walk with him in Jesus' name. In 2 Chronicles, I'm reading here from verse 3. 2 Chronicles chapter 17. 2 Chronicles chapter 17, and we're reading from verse 3. Look at what it says in verse 3. And the Lord was with Jehoshaphat, because he walked in the first ways of his father David, and sought not unto Baalim, but he sought the Lord God of his father, and walked in his commandments, and not after the doings of Israel. Therefore, you see that? The Lord was with him. He walked in the ways of David, his father. And then we're told he sought the Lord, and he walked after his commandments. And it says, therefore, because of walking with the Lord, therefore, the Lord established the kingdom in his hand. And all of Judah brought to Jehoshaphat presents, and he had riches and honor in abundance. It's coming your way. I said, it's coming your way. When you walk, whether people are there or they are not, and you say, I've chosen the way of truth, I'm going to walk in the way of the Lord, it says the blessings will multiply in your life. It will, in Jesus' name. In Zechariah, I'm reading from chapter 3. Zechariah chapter 3, and we're reading here from verse 3. Zechariah chapter 3. The returns while walking courageously with the Lord. In Zechariah chapter 3, we're reading from verse 3. Look at what it says. It says in verse 3, now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments, and stood before the angel, and he answered and spake unto those that stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garment from him. And this day is the day of cleansing, and this day is the day of the change of life. Any filthiness, the Lord will take it away. He will cleanse every one of us through and through. Inside, he will cleanse you. Outside, he will cleanse you. Language, it will cleanse you. Attitude, it will cleanse you. Your morals, it will cleanse you. Take the filthy garment away from him. And unto him he said, behold, I have caused thy iniquity to pass from thee, and I will clothe thee with change of raiment. And I said, let them search a fair matter upon his head. So he searched a fair matter upon his head, and he clothed him with garments, new garments. And the angel of the Lord stood by. And the angel of the Lord protested unto Joshua, saying, listen to this, thus says the Lord of hosts, if thou wilt walk in my ways, that's the condition, if thou wilt walk in my ways, and if thou wilt keep my charge, then thou shalt also judge my house, and shalt also keep my courts, and I will give thee places to walk among these that stand by. among the courageous, among the conqueror, among the captains, among the angels, among the saints, I give you a place among these that stand by. You see what the Lord is saying? He says everything depends on our walk with God. You're walking with God. Like Enoch, he started with redemption. He went on in righteousness. He ended with rapture. Like Enoch, he started with grace. Then he continued with the government of the reign of God upon his life. And then he ended up with the glory of the rapture. And then eternal rewards being given to us. That leads me to point number three, eternal rewards for walking conscientiously. Walking conscientiously with God. My brother, my sister, to walk with God, you have to retrieve and recover and restore your conscience. You have to restore your conscience. But because, you know, in the world in which we're living now, all the people around us, their consciences are seared with a hot iron. That's why you'll find, you know, all these things we read about in the papers, they do unnatural things. They do terrible things. They do things that are of iniquity. And it's like there's no conscience. It's like they do not understand that this is evil. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4. I'm reading from verse 1. It says, now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy. Look at this. Having their conscience, tell me out loud, having their conscience seared with a hot iron. You see, all the people that talk to you in the world, if you're not saved, even those who claim they're saved, their conscience is seared with a hot iron. And they can do whatever and say whatever. They can blaspheme. They can disrespect the name of God and the word of God, and their conscience will not raise any objection. So you cannot depend on them. You cannot depend on their advice. You cannot depend on their lifestyle, because it says in these last days, they'll speak lies in hypocrisy because they have their conscience seared with a hot iron. But you, if you're going to live this courageous life and this conscientious life, something must happen to your conscience. Look at Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9. I'm reading from verse 14. Hebrews chapter 9. We're reading from verse 14. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. You need that initially, at the beginning. If you're going to walk with God, and you need to reset your life and reset your heart even today and say, Lord, as I look at my lives, I just, you know, fall to this and fall into that and do this and practice that. It's like my conscience doesn't talk anymore. My conscience doesn't reprove me anymore. My conscience doesn't say anything anymore. You go back to Calvary, and then the blood of Jesus Christ that is shed for your redemption will purge your conscience from dead works. Then what happens after that conscience is purged? Look at 1 Timothy chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 9. 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 9. It says, holding the mystery of the faith in a pure conscience. Holding the mystery of the faith. No matter what message you hear, and no matter what depths of mystery or revelation is given unto you, if your conscience is not purified, you're not going to benefit by the preaching of the word. But when you hear the word, when you hear the message, and your conscience has been cleansed, and your conscience has been purified, and your conscience has been purged, and your conscience has been sanctified, then you are able to hold that message and that mystery of the gospel in a pure conscience. Look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 24. Acts of the Apostles chapter 24. I'm reading here from verse 16. Acts chapter 4, verse 16. And herein do I exercise myself to have always, always, always. If anything gets wrong with the conscience anytime, you cannot live right. If your conscience is deadened any area, you cannot live right. If your conscience is affected and seared with a hot iron in an area, and you have a blind spot in that area, you'll not be able to live righteously. But when your conscience is purged, your conscience is purified, and you always have a conscience that is void of offense toward God and toward men, that's how you can walk with God like Enoch walked with God. And then for such people, it's going to give us eternal reward. Somebody there, eternal rewards. Eternal rewards for walking conscientiously with God. I'm reading Psalm 15. I'm reading from verse 1. Psalm 15, reading from verse 1. Lord, who shall abide in thy tabernacle? Who shall dwell in thy holy hill? He that walketh uprightly. You see that? He that walketh, not those who walk in the past, not those who are planning to walk in the future, every day of their lives, those who walk uprightly, those who walk righteously, and walketh righteousness, and speaketh the truth in his heart. You know, there are people that can tell lies, their conscience is dead, and they don't bat an eye. They will tell you a lie confidently with a smile. They'll tell you a lie. You're not even seeing their body language. They're telling a lie. They're not getting ready for heaven. They're afraid of man. What do you tell lies? You're afraid of, you know, if that person knew the truth about this situation, I might be, rebuked or corrected or whatever. And because you're afraid of man, you're not afraid of God, and you're not thinking of your heaven. All you're thinking about is, I want to set my face at this time. But Lord, who shall abide in thy tabernacle? Who shall dwell in thy holy hill? He that walketh uprightly and walketh righteousness and speaketh the truth in his heart. He that backbiteth not with his tongue, nor doeth evil to his neighbor, nor taketh up a reproach against his neighbor, in whose eyes a vile person is contemned, and he honoreth them that fear the Lord. He that sweareth to his heart and changeth not. He that sweareth to his heart and changeth not. He that putteth not out his money to usury, and that he is to unlawful gain, and not taketh reward against the innocent. He that doeth these things shall never be moved. Those are candidates for heaven. I'll be a candidate for heaven. We're looking at Psalm 24. I'm reading from verses 3 and 4. Psalm 24, verses 3 and 4. It says, who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who shall stand in his holy place? He that has clean hands. He that has clean hands. Hands that will not touch defilement. Hands that will not touch another man's wife. Hands that will not embrace another man's husband, another woman's husband. He that has clean hands. Hands that will not be sticky, that will not touch church money. Hands that will not touch office money. Hands that will not steal. Hands that will not touch their wine. Hands that will not hold their cigarette. Lord, who shall ascend unto the hill of the Lord? Or who shall stand in his holy place? He that has clean hands and a pure heart. And a pure heart and a pure conscience too. Who has not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully, he shall receive the blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Psalm 73. In Psalm 73, I'm reading from verse 23. Psalm 73, and we're looking at verse 23. Psalm 73, verse 23. Here is what the word of the Lord is emphasizing once again. It says, nevertheless, I am continually with thee. Continually, I'm conscious of the fact that he sees everywhere I go. He hears every conversation I take part in. He sees everything I do. And because he's observing everything, nevertheless, he says, I am continually with thee. Thou hast holding me by the right hand. Thou shalt guide me with thy counsel, and afterward receive me to glory. you'll guide me. And if I'm following that guidance, you'll teach me. If I'm following that teaching, you will instruct me. If I'm following that instruction, and you will counsel me. If I'm following that counseling, if I'm following the guide and the counsel and the truth and the teaching of the Spirit of God, it says, thou shalt guide me with thy counsel, and afterward receive me to glory. Whom have I in heaven but thee? And there is none upon the earth that I desire beside thee. There's nobody on earth that is going to bend my will and change my course. There's nobody on earth that is going to be so strong as to make me divert my way and go away from the path of righteousness. Whom have I in heaven but thee? And there is none upon the earth that I desire beside thee. My flesh and my heart faileth, but God is the strength of my heart, and is my portion forever. Is my portion forever. He'll be your portion in Jesus' name. Isaiah chapter 33. Isaiah chapter 33, and I'm reading from verse 15. Isaiah chapter 33, and we're looking at it from verse 15. It's talking about the eternal reward of those who walk conscientiously with the Lord. Isaiah chapter 33, verse 15. He that walketh righteously and speaketh uprightly, he that despiseth the gain of oppressions, that shaketh his head from holding of bribes, that stoppeth his ears from hearing of blood, or shutteth his eyes from seeing evil. Look at that verse again. It says, you'll not hold bribe if you want to make it to those pearly gates. You want to be like Enoch. Not only that, it said, you'll not delight in looking at all the films and all the pictures and all the drama that talks about crime, about corruption, about adultery, about fornication, and that glorify all the immoralities of the world, and that encourage, whether it's in the papers, or it's in the news, or it's in the radio, or it's on television, or it's on the internet. Look at what it says. It says, you know, when you look at, you know, all the things that the media people are putting out today, and they're saying that, you know, if you are going to, you know, live healthy and live all right, you must be meeting with 10, 20, 30 women in your life. That if you stay with just one woman, you will not be healthy. There are people of psychology and there are people of research. They have found it out that if you're going to live healthy, you must do this and do that. And if you waste your life with that, those ideas will send you to hell. But you're going to stand by the word of God. Somebody there said you'll stand by the word of God. The world is about to corrupt everything and everybody, but you will not be corrupted. Look at that verse 15 again. It says, he that walketh righteously and speaketh uprightly, he that despiseth the gain of oppressions, and he that shaketh his hands from holding of bribes, that stoppeth his ears from hearing of blood, and shutteth his eyes from seeing evil, he shall dwell on high. I will be there. His place of defense shall be the munitions of the rocks, and bread shall be given him, and his waters shall be sure. His eyes shall see the king in his beauty. It's talking about you'll see him on the day of rapture, and then you will go with him. It says, his eyes shall see the king in his beauty, and they shall behold the land that is far off. Somebody is saying amen over there. Isaiah chapter 35, I'm reading from verse 8. Isaiah chapter 35, verse 8, and an highway shall be there, and a way, and it shall be the way, it shall be called the way of holiness. You'll walk in that way. The way of righteousness, you'll walk there. The way of holiness, you'll walk there. And the way of sanctification and purity, you'll walk there in Jesus' name. It shall be called the way of holiness, and the unclean shall not pass over it, but it shall be for those the way-fearing men. No fool shall not err therein. No lion shall be there. I said no lion shall be there. The Bible says no lion shall be there. The Holy Ghost says no lion shall be there. It's not talking about the lion you see in the picture. It's not talking about the lion in the zoo. It's talking about the angry man. It's talking about the angry woman. It's talking about that furious, fierce personality. The one that is, you know, angry and can break this and break that. And the one that is so angry can kill another person. The one that is so angry and then he'll go out and he'll do some things. He thinks he's hurting other people. He thinks he's hurting the Christian. He thinks he's hurting the church. But he's hurting himself because he will not go to heaven. No lion, no angry personality will be there, nor any ravenous beast shall go up therein. It shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there. The redeemed, the righteous, the ransomed shall walk there, and the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with songs and with everlasting joy upon their heads, and they shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. We go into that place where there be no tears, where there be no sorrow, where there be no mourning, where there be no death, where there be no night, where there be no darkness, and where there be no pain, but everything will be light because the Lamb of God will be the light of that city. And thank God I'm going there. I said, thank God I'm going there. Enoch is there, you'll be there. Elijah is there, you'll be there. All those worthies of old, they are there. And that is where God is taking us to. He says, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, behold, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. He's coming again for me. I said, it's coming again for me. I said, it's coming again for me. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, so that where I am, there you will be also. What is the person I'm talking about? You'll be there. I said, you'll be there. I said, you'll be there. Why don't you rise up and make up your mind and say, like Enoch walked, he walked conscientiously, he walked courageously, he walked constantly, and he walked consistently with the Lord. I will be there, and nothing will draw me back. Nothing will draw me back. If you have become defiled because of your interaction with the people of this world, why don't you call upon the Lord now? And why don't you say, Lord, I'm going to start again. You will cleanse me. You will wash me, you will purge me, you will purify me, and you will help me so that my conscience will be the conscience of the righteous, and I will be there. I will be there. Make up your mind. You'll walk with God. You'll walk with God consistently. You'll walk with God courageously. You'll walk with God conscientiously.